Today is the first day of the 12th month on our Maker's restored calendar. It falls on the 7th day of the 2nd month on the calendar that Satan gave those who would be his children to use. It was on this day that the Most High gave his servant Ezekiel his Ezekiel chapter 32 prophecy. This prophecy is for the chief seat of the captivity of Mystery Babylon. Since the Most High gave us this prophecy on this day through his servant, I will read it to you. Verse 1, and it came to pass in the 12th year, in the 12th month, in the first day of the month, that Yahweh's word came to me, saying, Son of man, lift up a lamentation upon Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and say to him, you are like a young lion to the nations, and you are like a dragon in the sea. You flow forth in your rivers and stir up or muddy up the waters with your feet, and you foul the rivers. Pharaoh, king of Egypt, is a prophetic reference to the chief seat of the captivity. Therefore, it is a reference to the United States, who is the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel at this time. She is this young lion that is among the nations, that is like a dragon in the seas. The Most High's reference to her fouling the rivers is symbolic of her missionaries and ministries and such, spreading your whoredoms to the Most High and spreading your defiled baptism waters throughout the world. Those of you who remain in the captivity of Egypt remain clothed in your soiled garments. Your garments are soiled because you have washed in the foul rivers of Egypt instead of being washed in the water of life. And you have taken these foul rivers to those that you were supposed to take Yahweh's righteous statutes and judgments to. Verse 3, thus saith Yahweh Elohim, therefore I will spread out a net over you with an assembly of many people, and I will bring you up as the accursed thing that you are. I will forsake you upon the land. I will cast you forth before my face into the open field, and cause all of the fowls of the heaven to abide upon you. And I will fill the beast of all of the earth with you. I will lay your flesh upon the mountains and heap up the valleys with it. I will fill the channels with your blood and irrigate the land with it, and the mountains will swim in it. This verse ties in with the 200-mile-long river of blood that is spoken about in chapter 14, verse 20 of the revelations of his only begotten Son that is going to come out of the winepress. The testimony of his word that he has sent me with has tied this river into the 200-mile-long Jordan River, and his offer to turn your baptism waters into his only begotten Son's shed blood to atone for your sins, if you will turn back to him through that which he has restored. Verse 7, I will quench the heavens and make them dark. I will cover the stars, and I will cover the sun with a cloud, and the moon will not give her light. I will make all of the bright lights of heaven dark over you, and appoint darkness upon your land, saith Yahweh Elohim. I will bring affliction to your land, and will grieve the hearts of many people in your heathen nations that do not know me. Yahweh's word testifies that you are playing the whore to him if you are serving and worshiping and loving a make-believe image of who he is. In order to serve and worship and love him, you have to first know who he is. He is pure righteousness, and he commanded us to purge out all that opposes his righteousness from our midst. The G guy of Christianity loves and worships coexists with that which is evil in the Most High's eyes. Verse 10, many people will be astonished over you, and their kings will fear over you in terror when I brandish my sword before them in the day of your sudden fall, and they will tremble, every man for his own life. He is going to make an example of you to the rest of the world, and he is going to do so suddenly. Verse 11, because thus saith Yahweh Elohim, the sword will come upon the king of Babylon. His reference to the king of Babylon in this verse is also a prophetic reference to the chief seat of the captivity. It refers to the captivity of Mystery Babylon. Egypt and Babylon are both references to the captivity of the lies of Christianity that Yahweh gave you and our ancestors over to believe into. In Ezekiel chapter 20, his word tells us why he gave us over to believe into these lies. Verse 24, because you did not do my judgments, and you despised my statutes, and you profaned my Sabbaths, and your eyes were on following after your father's idolatries, your father's whoredoms. So I gave you over to statutes and to judgments that were not good, and that would not save your lives, that would not give you eternal life in his family. Back to Ezekiel chapter 32, I will cause your multitude to fall by the swords of warriors from oppressing nations, and they will spoil all of the pomp of Egypt, and all of the multitude thereof will be made desolate. All that is lifted up in arrogance before the Most High's face is going to be destroyed. It is not a coincidence that the video that he led me to produce on the first day of these 1,260 days that encompass his 42 restored 30-day months was called Arrogance Off the Charts. It is incredible how you are lifted up in pride and in arrogance above the testimony of his word. It is incredible how your own brand of righteousness exceeds his righteousness in your uncircumcised hearts and minds. The Most High has been in the process of rising up a confederacy of armies to come against you, and he is going to empower them to bring you low. Verse 13, the feet of your men will no longer stir up or muddy up the great waters. Neither will the hooves of your cattle stir them. I will destroy all of your cattle. At this time, the fouled up water in your rivers will sink and your oil will depart, says Yahweh Elohim. I will devastate the fullness of the land and make the land of Egypt desolate and smite all of them that dwell therein, and they will know that I am Yahweh. You are going to know his righteousness and his righteous judgment. This is the lamentations. The daughters of the nations that will mourn for her, they will mourn upon Egypt, and they will mourn for all of her multitudes, says Yahweh Elohim. He goes on to add more to this prophecy 14 days later. And it came to pass in the 12th year, in the 15th day of the month, that Yahweh's word came to me, saying, Son of man, wail for the multitude of Egypt, and cast her down, and cast down her daughters of the mighty nations into the lower parts of the earth, with them that are cast into the pit. Where will her delight be cast? Where will her glory be cast? She will lay with the uncircumcised. She will fall in the midst of them that are slain by the sword. Draw her and all of her multitude out, and deliver them over to the sword. The Almighty Elohim will appoint them and those that aid them to the midst of the grave. They will go down and lie with the uncircumcised, slain by the sword. Assyria, symbolic of those of you who think that you are upright in your own eyes, have your own brand of righteousness, will be there in all of your company. All of you will fall and your graves will be encompass you, slain by the sword, whose burial will be appointed in the borders of the pit, and your company will be encompassed in your graves. All of you who gave confusion to the land of the living will fall, slain by the sword. Those of you who taught others, including your children, to love and serve and a make-believe image of who the Most High is, are going to fall. Elam, symbolic of those of you who live thinking that your sins are hidden behind the make-believe blood of the make-believe image of his only begotten Son that you hide behind, will be there with all of your multitude, encompassed in your graves. All of you will fall, slain by the sword. Those of you who gave confusion to the land of the living will be cast down with the uncircumcised into the lower parts of the earth. You will bear your shame with the rest of them that go down to the pit. I will appoint a bed in the midst of the slain for all of the multitude of the uncircumcised. Your graves will encompass you, slain by the sword, because you gave confusion to the land of the living. You will bear your shame with them that are cast down to the pit, and you will be appointed to the midst of them that are slain. This part of this prophecy puts an emphasis on those of you who are in the captivity being uncircumcised, referring to you being uncircumcised in the heart. His reference to your grave being a bed is symbolic of your destruction resulting from your playing the whore to him by your loving and worshiping your different make-believe images of his true character. Here is what he tells us elsewhere about who is the uncircumcised of the heart in Ezekiel chapter 44. You come before my face as heathen children, uncircumcised in the heart and uncircumcised in the flesh to be in my sanctuary. And you profane my house. You bring all of your abominations unto my choice bread and blood. This is a prophetic reference to his bread of life and the substitution sacrifice that he set up through his only begotten son's shed blood. And you have disannulled my covenant. You've used his son's shed blood for license to transgress against him. Circumcision of the flesh is symbolic of us living by every word that he sent forth from his mouth on a physical plane. Therefore, his reference to being uncircumcised in the flesh is symbolic of those of you who do not live by every word that he sent forth from his mouth. Living by every word that he sent forth from his mouth is what circumcises our hearts. Doing so is the pathway that he gave to us to teach us to become as he is. Verse 8, you have not hedged about and guarded that which is holy or that which is set apart. Instead, you have set up yourselves a sanctuary. You have set up yourselves whorehouses to hedge about and to guard. His word in Ezekiel chapter 16 likens the buildings that you have set up on your corners that are in your streets and on your high hills that you call churches to whorehouses. They are whorehouses because they teach their flocks to love and worship a make-believe image of who he is. Therefore, they teach their flocks to play the whore to him. Verse 9, thus saith Adonai Yahweh, no heathen children. He goes on to tell us in this same verse that the heathen children that he is referring to are those of you who are of the scattered descendants of Israel who are strangers to him. No heathen children who are uncircumcised in the heart or uncircumcised in the flesh will enter into my sanctuary from all of the children who are strangers to me that are among the children of Israel. His only begotten son told us that he is going to tell those of you who live in violation of his father's Torah to depart from him because he does not know you. You are strangers to him. He and his father do not know you because you are strangers to them. You are uncircumcised in the heart because you have not lived that which would have circumcised your hearts. Back to Yahweh's to Ezekiel chapter 32 prophecy. He goes on in verse 26. Meshach and Tubal, symbolic of those of you whose security is in your possessions and in your wealth, will be there with all of your multitude. Your graves will encompass you because you have given confusion to the land of the living. All of you uncircumcised, slain by the sword. You will not lay with the mighty that fall, which are gone down to the grave uncircumcised. I will appoint your swords and your weapons of war under your heads, and your iniquities will be upon your bodies. You are not going to be buried because, like he said earlier, you are going to be cast into the fields for the birds and the beasts to consume, because you brought confusion to the mighty in the land of the living. The mighty that fall is a reference to those who would have laid siege to his ward and became his children if you had brought his righteousness to them and to those that you have taught or caused to stumble at his word. Verse 28, you who are in the midst of the uncircumcised will be broken as well, he says, and you will lie with them that are slain with the sword. Here he is telling you to flee from the midst of those who are uncircumcised in the heart, or you are going to fall with them. Flee from touching the dead per his magnification of his touching the dead statute and per his only begotten son's instructions for us to flee into the mountains now that the abomination of desolation has been revealed. Verse 29, Edom. Edom is symbolic of those of you who have sold your birthright for the things that are of this world. The lust of the flesh and the pride of life will be there with your kings and all of your princes with their might and appointed with them that were slain by the sword. And you will lie with the uncircumcised that go down to the pit. All of the dukes of the north, symbolic of those of you who deny or cover up your sins, and all of the Zidonians, symbolic of those of you who fish or hunt to entice or lure others to transgress against the Most High, will be there with those that are gone down to with the slain. Your might and your confusion will be put to shame, and you will lie with the uncircumcised that are slain by this word, and you will bear your shame. You will bear the shame of your nakedness with them that go down to the pit. Verse 31, look upon all of them and Pharaoh and all of their multitudes, even Pharaoh and all of his army slain by the sword, and see and repent, turn back to him, saith Yahweh Elohim. He is telling you to look upon this destruction when he sends it and turn back to him through that which he has restored. Because Pharaoh and all of his multitude gave confusion to the land of the living. They will be laid in the midst of the uncircumcised with them that will be slain with the sword, saith Yahweh Elohim. There are 40 days that encompass the first day of the 12th month and the 10th day of the first month in the Most High's restored 30-day months. He uses the number 40 to stamp his judgment upon things. And he has woven the number 40 throughout the dates that he had recorded in his word like this in a way that has added to the testimony of his restored 30-day months. In lieu of what the 10th day of the first month represents, this 40-day parallel is not a coincidence, nor are any of the rest of the 40-day parallels like this that he has woven into his word and into his end-time timeline that includes his restoration of his 30-day months, that include his restored timing of his Sabbaths and the rest of his appointed times in them. The 10th day of the first month is the day that we are told to set aside the Passover lamb or goats for the Most High's Passover memorial that is 4 days later each year. It is the day that Yahweh's only begotten son rode into Jerusalem on the ass's colt 4 days before he was killed. It is the day that our ancestors crossed over the Jordan on dry ground when they entered into the promised land. And it is the day that he gave to us for his temple measurement prophecy that begins in Ezekiel chapter 40. His temple is his 144,000 first fruits. This prophecy starts off in chapter 40 by telling us that the measuring line that his temple was measured with would be given into the hands of his end-time Son of Man. The measuring line that his temple was built with is his word. His word is the same word that his only begotten Son told us that all will be judged by in the last days. Those of you who are living, playing the whore to the Most High, loving and worshiping a make-believe image of who he is, are soon going to realize the judgment of his word that is upon you. His word likens your playing the whore to him to the golden calf that our ancestors had Aaron fashion for them when his servant Moses was up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. I will show you where and how it does. Yahweh's prophecy that he gave to us through his servant Jeremiah, that is a prophecy against the army of Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt, we are told in Jeremiah chapter 46, "As I live, saith the king, whose name is Yahweh of hosts, because as Tabor, referring to that which will be broken into pieces, is among the mountains, and as Carmel is by the sea, so shall he come." Carmel means a fruitful field. It was at Mount Carmel that his servant Elijah told those who turned back to Yahweh that day, Yahweh the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, that he told them to kill the prophets of Baal. Verse 10 of this prophecy tells us that this prophecy is for the day of Yahweh host vengeance. It is also a prophecy for him raising up a people to come against the scattered descendants of Israel who are in the captivity of Mystery Babylon, like he rose up Nebuchadnezzar and others to come against our ancestors for their rebellion to him. Verse 19, "You daughter who dwells in the captivity of Egypt, make yourselves ready," he says, "because Noph, the capital of Upper Egypt, will be burnt up and without an inhabitant. Destruction will come upon the beautiful heifer of Egypt. It will come upon her from the north." Wherever the Most High has pitched his camp for the past few years, he has given me a distant shofar sound to awake to in the mornings. The sound always seems to come from the north to the northeast. This morning, on this first day of the 12th month, that begins these 40 days, he more than doubled the sound when I woke up to it, and it was coming from the north. His word testifies that the primary two of the confederacy of nations that he is going to send upon you will be China and Russia. The song of his servant Moses that he gave to us to be a witness against the scattered descendants of Israel at the time of the end tells us that he is going to cause their arrows to not miss. He goes on, "Also her hirelings that are in her midst, the armies that which your money has purchased with your taxes and such, that are like stall-fed calves, for they will also turn and flee away together. They will not stand, because the day of their calamity and the time of their visitation, the time of you giving account for your rebellious works, will come upon you. The scattered descendants of Israel have put your trust in the hands of the armies that you have established in your coast and abroad, and not in the Most High. Our Maker requires us to walk with him in obedience to his word in order for us to receive the protection of his almighty hands. You are going to soon find this out. His word refers to Israel as those who are supposed to be both daughters and wives unto him. We are supposed to be his chaste bride. And here he likens in other places to the heifer. The beautiful heifer of Egypt in this verse is a prophetic reference to the high and lifted up scattered descendants of Israel that love and worship a make-believe image of our Creator. Like I said, he gave you over to believe into your different make-believe images of him because of your rebellion to his word. And you have dwelt in the captivity of Mystery Babylon as you have done so. You're bowing down to and loving and serving and worshiping the make-believe Elohim that the only true Elohim has given you over to believe into is no different than our ancestors having a golden calf fashioned to bow down to and to serve and worship. This is why he refers to you as a heifer. Just like with our ancestors and their golden calf, the make-believe image of the Most High that you serve and worship does not have eyes that can see, nor ears that can hear. And you are soon going to find this out as well. Yahweh's word testifies that our ancestors rose up to play the whore to him when they had the golden calf made that day. In like manner, his word testifies that each of you are playing the whore to him if your boots are under a bed of a make-believe image of who he is. Like I said, he is pure righteousness, and he commanded us to purge out that which opposes his pure righteousness from our midst. If the image of him that you serve and worship does not require you to burn that which is wrong in his eyes from our midst, then you serve and worship an idolatrous image of who he is. If the image of him that you serve and worship does not require you to live by every word that he spoke to us through his servants the prophets, then you serve and worship an idolatrous image of who he is. If the image of the Most High that you serve and worship tells you that you are saved into his kingdom by grace apart from the works of his Torah and delivered into his kingdom apart from being in agreement with his righteousness, then you serve and worship an idolatrous image of who he is. Such images of who he is are not testified to by his word. They are merely an image of him that your rebellious, uncircumcised hearts desire. Therefore, they are plainly idolatry. And according to his word, loving and worshiping and serving idolatry is playing the whore to him. In Hosea chapter 4, we're told, you do not account upon your daughters for their whoredom, nor upon your brides for their adultery, because you yourselves are separated under the whores, and you sacrifice with prostitutes. The people with no understanding will fall. He told us in the preceding verses, in verse 6 of this prophecy, that it is because you have rejected the knowledge that he made available to us that he has rejected you. In this same verse, he also told us that it is because you have forgotten his Torah that he has forgotten you. And he is going to continue to reject you and forget you unless you return to him through that which he has restored. Walking with him in his Torah, with his statutes and his judgments, causes him to give us his four spirits of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and knowledge that teaches his righteousness. Doing so in spirit and in truth is what teaches us to become one with him like his only begotten Son, who was made in the image of his word, was and is one with him. You have to reject his word in order to reject that he has sent me, and you have to reject his word in order to reject that which he has placed upon my tongue. His reference to sacrificing with prostitutes in this verse refers to your paying the false shepherds of your whorehouses to teach you to love and worship a make-believe image of who he is. Verse 15, if you, Israel, did not play the whore and Judah was not guilty, you would not go up to Gilgal nor ascend up to Beth-Aven, and you would not swear Yahweh lives. The reason why the whoredoms of the scattered descendants of Israel are an abomination to the Most High more than in the other religions is because you claim to be the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel's people. But you love and worship a different image of who he is. This is playing the whore to him. His righteousness is the only thing that will endure forever. In claiming to be the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel's children, you are swearing to bear his name. But instead, you summon yourselves to an idolatrous image of him that your rebellious, uncircumcised hearts desire. The third commandment that his finger wrote upon the two stone tablets tells us that he will not hold those who bear his name in a desolating way guiltless. This means that he is not going to pardon you for your doing so unless you turn from doing so. Gilgal is where our ancestors pitched Yahweh's camp when they crossed over the Jordan on the 10th day of the first month. It is where they kept the Passover after they crossed over into the Promised Land. Joshua chapter 5 verse 9 tells us that it is named Gilgal because it is where Yahweh took away the reproach of Egypt from our ancestors when they crossed over the Jordan and they kept the Passover. They trusted him and obeyed him at that time. But Yahweh putting Gilgal and Beth-Aven in the same verse, in a verse that associates these two places to playing the whore to him, is to point us to a negative and not a positive. His doing so is to point us to something specific that happened at these two places that he condemned. Gilgal is where King Saul was made to be king of Israel. Yahweh established him as king to be an example of a vessel to dishonor. Gilgal is where Saul rebelled against the Most High's word that he spoke to him through his servant Samuel. Saul's rebellion was he offered up an offering to Yahweh in rebellion to his instructions to not offer up to him without doing so through his priest. It was because of this rebellion to Yahweh's word that his word tells us that he would replace Saul with a man that sought after his heart. It was also at Gilgal where Saul repeated his rebellion to the Most High's word that he spoke through his servant Samuel. Yahweh instructed Saul to utterly destroy all of the Amalekites and all of that which they had, including their animals. Instead of obeying Yahweh's word, Saul kept their king alive and took the best of their livestock for a spoil. Then he brought this world to Gilgal, where he was going to sacrifice it unto Yahweh there. Notice both of Saul's rebellions involved him offering up to Yahweh. His problem was he did so in rebellion to Yahweh's word. Here is what Yahweh's servant told Saul at Gilgal that day. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, does Yahweh delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices like he does in obeying his voice? Behold, to hearken to Yahweh and to obey him is better than the sacrifice of the choice of rams. Because rebellion to him is like the sin of witchcraft, like the sin of divination, and to press against him is wicked and idolatrous. Because you have rejected Yahweh's word, he says, he has rejected you, Saul, from being king. Hosea chapter 9, verse 15, and chapter 15, verse 11, also refer to all of the wickedness that was found in Gilgal and the offering of the sacrifices in vain there. Yahweh also condemned that which took place at Gilgal through his servant Amos. Beth-Aven means house of iniquity. It is only referred to seven times in the scriptures. It was mentioned as being next to Ai in the account of Achan's rebellion to the Most High's word when he took the silver and the Babylonish garment and the gold tongue. It is mentioned in the account of King Saul's first rebellion when he offered up the burnt offerings to Yahweh because of there being 36, when he offered it up because of there being 36,000 Philistines gathered next to Beth Aven. And Saul feared, so he went to get Yahweh's instructions in offering up to him to beseech him that day. Here's some trivia for you. There were 36 of the men of Israel that Ai killed because Yahweh was not with them because of Achan's rebellion to his word that day. The 36,000 Philistines that brought on Saul's rebellion were a parallel to the 36 who died because of Achan's rebellion. Beth Aven was a marker in the border of the tribe of Benjamin. Both King Saul and Saul of Tarsus were of the tribes of Benjamin. And of course, Saul of Tarsus has been announced and testified to by Yahweh's word to be the abomination of desolation. Benjamin being like a ravening wolf in the last days, and how this ties in with the abomination of desolation is discussed in other videos. After Yahweh smote the Philistines through the hand of Jonathan, King Saul's son, the battle crossed over into Beth-Aven. It was here that Saul built an altar like unto the first altar that he built unto Yahweh. Yahweh did not answer him that day, and this resulted in him blaming his son Jonathan instead of acknowledging his own folly. Did Yahweh mention Beth-Aven here in Hosea chapter 4, verse 15, in association with playing the whore to him? And he does so again in Hosea chapter 5, verse 7 and 8. They, referring to the children of Israel, have transgressed against Yahweh, and they have brought forth children that are strangers to him. Henceforth, in a month, I will devour them amongst their portion. You have brought forth children with uncircumcised hearts that think they bear the Most High's name, like your own uncircumcised hearts that think you bear his name. You're strangers to him. Strangers that live in rebellion to him, that don't walk with him in his word. So he doesn't know you, like his only begotten son said. Verse 8, blow the shofar in Gibeah. A reference to Gibeah means hills, so a reference to the hills that your whorehouses are built upon. And the trumpet in Ramah, a reference to your high places. Ramah means high places, your high places that you commit your fornication on. And shout aloud at Beth-Aven, after you, Benjamin. I can assure you that after you, Benjamin, is not a coincidence. I said earlier that your whoredoms to the Most High with your adulteries are no different than our ancestors worshiping a golden calf. Here's the seventh and the last time that Beth-Aven, or the house of iniquity, is spoken about by the Most High in his scriptures of truth in Hosea chapter 10, verse 5. Because the heifers of Beth-Aven and the sojourning of the inhabitants of Samaria will bewail upon the people and upon the idolatrous priest, because their rejoicing and their glory will be uncovered from them. The arrogant, uncircumcised heifers of the house of iniquity rejoice and glory in your whoredoms to the Most High. You delight in your praises to the make-believe images of him that you serve and worship and love. He uses the word for uncovered here for a reason. The Most High is going to show you the shame of your nakedness. He is going to show you the shame of your opening your legs to play the whore to him. Back to Hosea chapter 4, verse 16. Because Israel is rebellious like a rebellious heifer. Again, referring to you as a heifer. Henceforth, Yahweh will feed you as a lamb in the wide open land. A lamb is prey to the beast in a wide open land. The Most High is not going to cover those of you who continue in your rebellion to Him. He is not going to cover you with His protective wings. Instead, He is going to uncover you and give you over to the beast of the field. He goes on to explain that the whoredoms and the idolatry that he is referring to is loving idols. And verse 17, Ephraim is joined to idols, joined to an idolatrous image of who the Most High is. And she is laid down, and she is turned aside by her wine, referring to the wine of fornication. And she commits whoredom exceedingly, and she exceedingly loves the shame of her shields. You love the idolatries that you hide behind. This whole Hosea prophecy includes all of Israel, but it puts an emphasis on Judah and Ephraim in some of the verses, like this one does with Ephraim. The Most High has gathered the majority of Ephraim and Judah into the United States for this time of trouble. In chapter 5, verse 4 of this prophecy, he links the spirit of whoredoms to not knowing Yahweh, referring to not knowing his true righteous character that he is. I'll read it to you. They will not give their work to turn back unto Elohim, because the spirit of whoredoms is in their midst, and they do not know Yahweh. The following chapters expand further upon your whoredoms. His word plainly testifies that loving and worshiping a different image of who he is playing the whore to him, especially if you're claiming to bear his name. Swearing to Yahweh lives. Yahweh, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel lives. Magnifies your whoredoms compared to those of the other religions of the world. The good news is he is going to uncover your fornication and show you your nakedness. He is going to show you the shame of your rejoicing and your glory and your whoredoms. His word says so.